We give you praise, O God. We magnify your holy name. Thank you for an opportunity to come before your throne of grace. Thank you for your faithfulness, O God. Thank you for being God every step of the way. We worship and we honor you, God. May your name alone be highly exalted in Jesus' name. This morning, Father, we commit everything into your hands. We call down the blood of Jesus Christ. That the blood of Jesus begin to flow in this church. As the blood flows, let everything that's not of God be pushed out in Jesus' name. We ask, oh God, that you release your angels of worship, your angels of warfare, your angels to take over in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Let the fire of God begin to burn in this place and burn to ashes everything that's not of God in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Have your way, O God, as we worship you, as we do all that we need to do today. Let your power come down. Thank you, Holy Spirit. We worship and we honor you. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
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 Shout hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
The Lord is good. Amen. I think we need to start shutting the door against latecomers by 9 o'clock on the dot. Amen.
Amen.
All right. Today, it's an introduction to a series I want to take for some time. We need to look at the significance of the altar. We talk about altar several times, but I'm going to take it a different route by the grace of God. What exactly is an altar? We're going to begin to look at the altar. Why is it necessary? Or why was an altar necessary? And why is this still necessary today? What nature does it take now, you know, compared to what used to be before? What's an altar now? Those are some of the things that we're looking at, not today, I mean, as we continue later on. So I'm just going to lay a foundation, and then we'll go from there. First, what is an altar? To answer that question, I want us to just look at the Bible. A classic altar. Let's look at Deuteronomy chapter 12, verse 27. Deuteronomy chapter 12, verse 27.
Deuteronomy 12, 27. That's what the Bible says. And thou shalt offer thy burnt offerings, the flesh and the blood, upon the altar of the Lord thy God. And the blood of thy sacrifices shall be poured out upon the altar of the Lord thy God, and thou shalt eat the flesh.
All right, let's stop there. Now, let's also look at Psalm 118, verse 27. Psalm 118, verse 27. Amen. Now let me bring the two together. We already understand it. A classic altar involved preparing a location. A location. For there to be an altar, there has to be a location. A location. Number one. There has to be a location. An altar is not just
put anywhere. There's always a reason for an altar. In the Old Testament, you see that altars were constructed not anyhow. So first, there must be a location must be selected. It's important. Why is a location important? It is important because it is not everywhere, especially in the olden days. It's not everywhere you want to cite a place where you want to worship God. It has to be a place that has spiritual significance, either in the church or somewhere where you had an encounter with God. When you look at Old Testament throughout, you look at the life of Abraham, each time God appeared to him, he erect an altar. That from the life of Abraham, Isaac, you see that. Okay, let's look at something here. Let's even look at the Bible quickly to just buttress what I'm talking about. Let's talk about Isaac. Let's look at Genesis 26, verse 25. We start from Abraham. Genesis 12, verse 8. I'm talking about location. There's a reason why I'm looking at it. We're going to tie these to ourselves. We're looking at the classic old Bible days. Genesis 12, verse 8.
Verse 8 says, "And he removed from them unto a mountain on the east of Bethel, and pitched his tent, having Bethel on the west and Hai on the east. And there he built an altar unto the Lord and called upon the name of the Lord."
If you understand what Bethel means spiritually, the altar was not just built anyhow. It wasn't just built at any location. It has to be a location with spiritual significance. If you look at Genesis chapter 13, verse 1 to 4, still Abraham.
"And Abraham went up out of Egypt, he and his wife, and all that he had, and Lot with him into the south. And Abraham was very rich in cattle, in silver, and in gold. And he went on his journeys from the south even to Bethel, unto the place where his tent had been at the beginning, between Bethel and Hay, unto the place of the altar which he had made there at the first."
Now, let's stop there. Abraham went back to that same altar that he built. Now, let's do quickly at the life of Isaac, Genesis chapter 26, verse 25. Just built anyhow. It was built at areas, locations that had spiritual significance. Many of these places were places that God appeared to his children. If you look at Jacob, when Jacob built an altar, it was at a location that God appeared to him. He saw that angels were descending, ascending, and descending. And when he woke up, he said, "Oh, for real, God is at this place." He built an altar. We are going somewhere. So number one, altars are not just built anyhow. We started by looking at the traditional altar. We look at Deuteronomy chapter 12, verse 27. Psalm 108, why did I have to bring that in? He said, tie the sacrifice even to the horns of the altar. So it means that in the days of old, an altar to be built with four horns, with four legs, or four posts, four pillars. One, two, three, four. And that's how he said, tie the sacrifice even unto the horns of the altar. We'll come to that. So number one, the altar is built at a specific location. Number two, an altar is built with specific dimensions. It has to have four pillars, four posts, location, dimension. Number three, an altar has to have a sacrifice. There must be a sacrifice on an altar. That's why I say, tie the sacrifice even unto the horns of the altar. So if there's a sacrifice, it means that every often there will be blood. You cannot tie a goat or whatever and you kill it and there will not be blood. So an altar has to have blood. Number four, an altar has to have blood. There must be a sacrifice. And number five, there has to be a service, meaning there must be a worship. Sacrifice is not enough if you don't use it to worship. That's number five. There has to be a worship. Now, what are the spiritual significances of all this thing that we're talking about? We look at the olden days. What a sacrifice used to look like. What an altar used to look like. If I want to translate that, I can stop and anybody ask a question. Because I'm not preaching. I wanted to just the introduction because we're going to go in depth at some point. I see Mr. Tony is looking at me so confused. What are we talking about? Anybody has anything you want to, before we continue? I just mentioned five significances of the traditional altar. Can you tell about what an altar used to be for in the days of old? Yes.
Could you repeat number four?
Number four, I tell you about a sacrifice. There has to be blood. An altar has to have blood for it to be complete. Because when you tie a sacrifice and you kill it, the blood must spill. Mm-hmm.
Church, the Pentecostal church, a new altar?
We'll come to that. Yeah, it did, of course. But does that mean that the traditional altar is completely done with?
The straw, uh-huh.
Those are the areas that we'll be looking at throughout this, not today, even as we continue.
Just want to for you to clarify this. It just came to my mind. You know, when Jesus met that Samaritan woman at the well,
said in the old, your fathers used to come here to worship, that, you know, there will be a time that you worship God in spirit and in truth. And does that mean the altar of God now is in our heart, or do we really need to go and create a place and then have an altar?
Good question. The answer to that is this. What Jesus meant by that was that there used to be annual, if you like, call it a ritual, once a year. Yeah, where you have to go to offer sacrifice at a specific location unto God. Every year, once a year, you have to go there. Just like the Muslims are doing now, they just copied that from what used to happen. Once a year, they go to Mecca to go and offer their sacrifice. They kill ram, kill all sorts of things. That's exactly what was going on. And you have to do, it was considered part of the rites you have to do as a Christian, or that day it wasn't called Christian, as a worshiper of Yahweh. But the coming of Jesus Christ made that no more necessary. To go on annual pilgrimage once a year to go offer sacrifice. What Jesus meant was that now you don't need to do that anymore. You can talk to me directly because now the altar is you. But he did not nullify the fact that wherever there's a place of worship, there is an altar. But the only difference is that this altar that you have now is spiritual altar. We don't need to bring blood here. And even in your house, even when you sit down to worship God, that is your altar. Wherever you move to, you have an altar of God. If you sit there, if you like, you can create a space or have a prayer room where the family member will gather, and then you worship God. That's your altar. Yes.
If when we are asked to define an altar without the physical descriptions, where would that be?
An altar is a place of intense spiritual activity. Where do I get that definition from? When Jacob had a revelation, he saw the angels of God ascending and descending at a particular location. When he woke up, he said, oh my God, for real, God is in this place. Generally and specifically speaking, anywhere there's an order, even in the demonic kingdom, the presence, spiritual presence, is great, very, very powerful at that, you know, location. So an altar is a place of spiritual, intense spiritual activity. It's a place you can stand and begin to communicate with God. Yeah, my brother.
I was going to, you defined or you explained earlier how the wherever you stand to pray becomes your altar, or the person becomes the altar.
Mm-hmm.
And I was trying to reconcile with how you can tie the sacrifice to the four corners, and what will be the four corners of that.
Exactly. I just laid an introduction. We're going to go in there. But let me quickly jump into that since you bring that up. Like I said, an altar to have four posts. And you put your sacrifice on the altar and tie that sacrifice to the four posts of the altar. There's a spiritual significance to that, number one. Or let's look at physical significance. You are tying the animal to the four posts so that the animal would not escape. That's literally the physical. While you tie it, so that animal would not escape. Because the animal by nature, this is not a dead animal. You have to understand. You don't sacrifice a dead thing. You sacrifice a live animal. So if you just leave it on the altar, the tendency is that the animal could escape, because animal knows that something's going to go on here. Amen. So it's going to struggle. Mm-hmm. And even when you're about to slaughter him, it can escape. So you tie him to the four posts of the altar to prevent him from escaping. That is physical. Now, what is the spiritual significance of that? You tie your sacrifice, it signifies humility. It signifies surrender. It signifies willingness. The sacrifice you have might not be goat anymore, or ram, or lamb, or whatever. The sacrifice of God, the Bible says, is what? A broken heart, a contrite spirit. The sacrifice of today, I wanted to get to that later at some other point, but let's since you bring it up, it is no more ram, lamb, goat. But it's now our lives. That is the sacrifice that God desires. But just like the old gold and lamb that we used to have, it is has to be tied to the four posts to hold it down. What are the four posts? Number one. Let's look at quickly. If you look at Romans, we're going to have more time to go in depth. Romans chapter 12, verse 1.
Romans 12, 1.
Mm-hmm.
Paul said, I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that ye present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service.
So we are bodies, the living sacrifice. Look at the 1 Corinthians 13, 13.
And now abide faith, hope, love, these three, but the greatest of these is love.
Amen. Is that all other gifts of the Spirit? Three. Amen. Faith, hope, love. The greatest of these is love. The three pillars now is hope, faith, love. And there's a fourth, a pillar. The Lord showed me when I was writing one of my books some years ago. It's called perseverance. To be able to tie down this your sacrifice, which is you now, to be able to tie down your life on the altar of God, to be able to be a sacrifice, a reasonable sacrifice unto God, to be able to keep yourself holy and acceptable unto God. You're going to need to tie yourself on the altar of God on the four cords. And these cords are faith, hope, love, and perseverance. Those are the four cords of the altar. Without these four cords, your sacrifice cannot stay on that altar. Those are the cords. Without these four, let me repeat, the sacrifice cannot stay on that altar. Anybody has questions? Because I see people are wondering. Yes.
You have defined the meaning of an altar, an intense place where there's spiritual, godly spiritual activity. It could be the other side too. But what would cause this altar to become dormant.
To become dormant.
To become dormant or don't have any fire in it. Anymore.
Okay, let's go exactly. I mean, I like the word fire. Let's go to the Old Testament. There has to be a sacrifice before there was the fire. Do you know that?
Yeah, I mean, even this. When the
yeah, I'm coming. Okay. Fire cannot catch the altar without sacrifice. Even in the days of where God will set the fire himself, there are situations, I'm sure if you read the Bible, there were situations that fire would come down on its own to consume the sacrifice. That no man, no priest will set the fire. They will lay the sacrifice, fire will come down and consume it. Now the question is, that fire cannot come down unless there's a sacrifice. Because fire cannot come on an empty altar. Which means, for there to be fire on the altar, there had to be sacrifice. Are we understanding what I'm trying to
say?
I'm trying to relate to Abraham to sacrifice Isaac. You know, the boy, the Bible said the boy was carrying firewood. And when Abraham got to the place where he was going to sacrifice Isaac, he pulled down stones and then he laid the fire on it, the firewood on it. And not until he actually does the killing, he cannot light the firewood. So first of all, he has to lay the fire, prepare the altar, and then lay the animal on the altar, tie the animal. Those things that God had not given them the description of the altar. So they were laying stones, but the stones had four corners. Stones had four corners, so he put the firewood on it, and then tied the leg of the animal. That's like Pastor said, submission. You make the animal submit, and then they will slaughter the animal, and everything, the blood, everything goes on the altar. Before that time, Abraham would not eat any of them because God had, at that time, had not given them the description as to what to do until he, in Deuteronomy, when he gave the law. So he light, after that he will light the fire and everything will be burned unto God.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
What it means therefore, your question was, what will make the altar not to have the fire? So you have to understand, like I said before, and like Father Ronde said, there must be a sacrifice before fire can come down. Which means therefore, any altar you can have, there can be an altar, but without the proper sacrifice, fire cannot come down. So which means that what will make the fire of God dormant is when the proper sacrifice is not there. Translating that into our life now, what will make our altar, since we are the altar of God now, what will make our lives dormant without fire? Is when we do not present our bodies, our lives, as a sacrifice unto God. When we don't submit and humble ourselves, when we don't tie our lives to the four posts of the altar, with hope, love, faith, and perseverance, that is when that altar will stay without fire. Which means, therefore, there are many altars today with no fire. There might be altars, because when you are born again, the altar of God comes to you, but you might not carry fire, because you are not a living sacrifice. There cannot be fire. Fire cannot come down on an empty altar. There has to be sacrifice before there can be fire. Yes, my brother.
So, from what you just said, I'm thinking, could it also mean then that you can have the four pillars and still without the sacrifice there wouldn't be any fire?
No fire. Even with the four pillars everything has to come together. There has to be a sacrifice tied to the four posts before fire can come down.
So hope, faith
love,
perseverance would not even ignite the fire without
it. Wouldn't ignite the fire unless there's a sacrifice. All of these things has to come together for there to be. When we have more time, we're going to expound more on this. The four has to come together. It means, therefore, we can go to church, we can pray and fast, yet we are not on fire for God. It doesn't matter whether you are a pastor, or whether you are a member in the church, without these things, there can never be fire. Yes.
Amen. Because of our time,
I know people have a lot to say, but we have to stop there because of our time. We're going to continue because I laid five physical significance that has to happen in the days past. I said, altar was not just built anyhow. It has to be a location. There has to be a reason. There has to be a preparation, a specific design of the altar. There has to be a sacrifice. There has to be blood. There has to be worship. These are all the areas that we're going to look at carefully, each one of them, to see how that relate to our spiritual life. And the four pillars, you need to understand that these are things that will keep us standing.